because usually it's time for other things and not for wearing a samat. When I was invited to come here, I started to think, looking at the title of the workshop of the school, that incidentally have something to speak about, which is non-local, which is involved with probability, which involves some PDEs, and so why not? So this is part of a series of work that I'm started to write alone. Since when you are old, then you begin to think that it's better to do what you like, and not. And when I started with this job, I'm saying around the 70s of the last century, so it's a long time ago, I started with information theory, and it's something that it remained. Yeah? And so since now I have plenty of time, excluding bureaucracy, which is, you know, it takes a lot of time for other things. So I restarted to think about, with the experience of a life, let's say, with the experience about Boltzmann equation, about entropies, about convergence to equilibrium, and so it's something that, you see, and you will see what happens, yeah? At least in this. I will split my talk in two parts. More in the first part, I will spend maybe more than 5 minutes to give you some sort of picture of what is known, starting from the beginning of this story. And then I will introduce a concept that apparently is very useful, and it would be nice if someone else will improve what I did, which is the concept of fractional Fisher information. This has to do with this non-local part of this workshop. And I don't know much about fractional calculus, but the funny story about this is that I was reading a paper by Luis Caffarelli and Juan Luis Vasquez about a porous medium equation with fractional pressure in 2011 or 2012, I do not remember. And looking at this paper, I said, oh, nice, they are really nice. Nothing physical, but this is an interesting idea. And so something remained in my mind, and so especially the definition of fractional derivative, let's say. Now, I'm laughing, but it put to my attention the fact that you can use fractional equation to derive something. And this is, and there is a context, which is probability, as we will see, with this fits perfectly. And then in the second part, I will explain what can you do with this stuff. And the main argument here is to derive some sort of logarithmic type Sobolev inequality for these Levy densities, which I retain from one side is new, from the other side is not so sharp, and maybe it will deserve further investigations. And then why this, since any time that you know that there is a logarithmic Sobolev inequality, then you can improve the results, you can prove L1 converges and so on, that was not known in this context. And then at the end I will put a list of my works on this. So the starting point is the concept of Shannon entropy. Unlikely, I don't speak about Boltzmann H functional, but since people working in information theory, starting from the fundamental two papers by Claude Shannon, they call this Shannon entropy. So since if you want to publish on journals, so for example, IEEE on information theory, so you have to use this notation, so I will use this notation again. But in any case, you know, it's the integral of minus f log f. More or less the difference with respect to the H function is that I take minus, and so I will see the increasing of entropy. This is nothing more. And the entropy satisfies a very nice inequality that was postulated by Shannon and then proved more than 10 years later by Stamm in his PhD thesis. And if you take two independent random vectors, and then what you can prove is that the entropy of the sum, or if you prefer, the convolution of the entropy of the convolution of the two densities in dimension n, here n is the dimension of the space in which you're working, is bigger or equal than the sum of the two entropy powers. Yeah? This is a nice inequality, and I will explain why. And the reason is that you can saturate this inequality in a very easy way. You take a Gaussian random vector, you take a Gaussian density, and then you take the covariance, which is sigma times the identity, and then you plug in the entropy power, and when you evaluate the entropy power, which is this quantity, you see that this is linear in the variance. Yeah? And so the entropy power inequality for the sum of two Gaussians simply says that A plus B is equal A plus B, which is not difficult to prove. Yeah? Now, how to prove this is a completely different story. It's very nice to see, to look at the whole history, since, you know, f log f is a bad function to work with. But there is another interesting function which is a quadratic form, which is easier to work with, which is the Fisher information. The Fisher information is defined as the integral of the gradient of f squared over f of x and x. And there is a nice bound between the entropy and Fisher information that I will explain later on. So why this is interesting in what I will prove? For this simple reason. There are strong connections between the entropy power inequality and the central limit theorem, which is a classical theorem in probability theory. So you take, what says the central limit theorem. Here I take independent, identically distributed random variable of zero mean. I forgot to say, but in any case, they are centered. And so you take the sum, and then you divide by square root of n. And then you apply the entropy power inequality with two variables, and immediately you fall down that h of s2 is bigger or equal than h of s1. And then you can repeat this idea proving that the entropy is increasing along the subsequence s with the index 2 to the power k. So the entropy power inequality seems to give an entropic proof of the central limit theorem. Yeah? And this has a lot of connection with, let's say, with Boltzmann theory. So in this case, if you, it's easy to verify that the sequence s sub n is such that if you take the random variable centered of a certain mass, mean and variance are preserved. In other words, you have a sequence which, with all the conservations of the solution of the Boltzmann equation, which as I saw this morning Laurent de Villette speaking about, you know, you have relaxation to equilibrium in a situation in which the solution of the equation preserves mass, momentum, and energy. And in which way you prove convergence to equilibrium? You prove convergence to equilibrium using the fact that the entropy is monotonically increasing. And so you are trying to think that this still holds. This is a very old problem, by the way. The first time that I touched this problem was reading a paper by Barron, I think, in maybe 75 or something like that. Yeah? So it's a very old problem, but interestingly enough, it was very difficult to prove this conjecture. So for example, it was very difficult to pass from 2 to 3. Huh? And only in 2002, Arnstein, Ball, Barth, and Naur succeeded. And then there are many proofs. Once the door has been opened, and then simpler proof came. And so, for example, Madiman and Barron in 2007 gave a really a nice proof, very simple, to understand why this phenomenon works. And once again, they used Fisher information bounds. So in a sense, what you are doing with entropy is really easier if you work with Fisher information. So in kinetic theory, you know, or at least you that there are situations in which you know that there is a decay towards the equilibrium with a certain rate. In this case, there is a decay rate of h of sn towards the h of the Gaussian, the Hermite density, which is the upper bound. And what is important is quantify this gap. And so people started to work on this, and there are interesting results for log concave densities. Since, in a sense, log concave densities are very close to the Gaussian densities, and so you have more instruments to work with. Yeah? Now, the relationship between the entropy and Fisher information still is another thing that is well known. You take the heat equation, so for example, take k equal 1, and then compute the evolution in time of the entropy functional and of the derivative of the entropy functional with respect to time. So Stamm used this idea in 59, but the funny story is that in 65, there is a nice paper by Henri McKean, which is concerned with Katz's caricature of a Maxwell gas, in which he studied the evolution of the derivatives of the functional with, that one can derive from the entropy functional applied to the heat equation for the simple reason that he wanted to prove there, at that time there were a conjecture, completely false, that if you take the subsequent derivatives of the H functional, they alternate in sign. And so he succeeded up to the order 2, and so evaluated the Fisher information, which is the derivative of u, then this j of f, which is minus 1 half of this derivative, at the 2 order, this is verified, but then it fails. And now we know that for concave density, you can go up to the 3rd order, but no more. And so here, taking subsequent derivatives, the situation becomes more and more intricated. But in any case, everything is done in terms of the subsequent derivative of the logarithm of f. Eh? And the first derivative and the second derivative, say the Fisher information, the second derivative are related, and there is another interesting inequality that coupled them. So it seems that any time that you take the heat equation, you take subsequent derivatives of the H function, then you recover interesting inequalities. Yeah? So why Fisher information is so nice? Fisher information is so nice for the simple reason that when you take the Fisher information of the sum, the Fisher information of the sum is less or equal than the Fisher information of both multiplied by two constants with sum equal to, by the square of two constants, which squares with sum equal to 1, yeah, which is given here. And if you optimize with respect to this constant, then you get that 1 over the Fisher information of x plus y is bigger or equal than 1. So this is called Blackmann-Stamm inequality, and is the corresponding of the entropy power inequality, since if you plug inside two Gaussian densities, 1 over I of x for a Gaussian density is still linear, and so it is another time is a plus b equal a plus b. This is what we have, and let me spend 5 minutes perceive the consequences of this that seems a game. Now, taking the entropy power inequality, one of the two random variable, like a normal density, and then multiply by two time t. And then you use the entropy power inequality, and then you know that this is linear, and the value is 4 pi e, by the definition of the entropy power corresponding to the normal density. So put in this way, divide by t, and this is bigger or equal of 4 pi a. And then take t to 0, and so you get this inequality. This inequality relates the entropy power to the Fisher information, and it's very powerful. So for example, it implies logarithmic Sobolev inequality with a remainder, which is very easy to derive. So I wrote a short paper saying that one of the consequences is that the entropy power inequality includes the logarithmic Sobolev inequality, but with a remainder, which is still stronger. And this is nice, isn't it? So it's nice, it's surprising, since in 75, Blackmann completed the proof of Stamm. And so the logarithmic Sobolev inequality was known, at least in this form, 10 years before of the paper by Gross. Yeah? And if you do the same on the Blackmann-Stamm inequality, Still, you plug the sum of x, and then you take one of the two others, which is normal, and so you obtain the same. This is linear. And then, passing to the limit, you get this other inequality, which relates the first derivative to the second one. And this is a simple proof of what Costa proved with a long proof in 1985, saying that this functional is concave in T. You take, and the linearity is achieved only when you are Gaussian. So plenty of inequality, and this can be generalized to Reni entropy and then to nonlinear diffusion equation, obtaining as consequence not the logarithmic Sobolev inequality, but Galliardo-Nirenberg inequalities. And this has been done by myself and Savary a few years ago. So this is the picture in the nice case. In the case in which the object is the heat equation, in which there is the normal density, and this is what we know. We know almost all. Since, you know, any time that you know that there exists something like the logarithmic Sobolev inequality, you can pass weak result to L1 result and so on. What was not so known is the situation in the case of the central limit theorem for stable laws. What says the central limit theorem for stable laws? You take the sum as before, but instead of dividing by 1/2, you divide by n to 1 over lambda. Yeah? When lambda is a number, in our case, between 1 and 2. Yeah? The number 2 corresponds to the Gaussian case. And what is known is that if you start close, close to a Lewy symmetric stable variable, so you are in the so-called domain of attraction of the stable variable, then the law of Tn converges towards the law of zeta lambda weakly. A Lewy symmetric stable law you define in Fourier is e to the minus c to the power lambda. I normalize to be clear. When lambda is equal to 2, you have the Gaussian. When lambda is less than 2. The big problem is that the Lewy stable law has no second moment. There is no representation in the physical space, but in any case, it is known that you have only a certain number of moments which are bounded. So it has tails. And this is the reason why you have to choose an initial random variable which more or less has the same tail at infinity. This is the analogous of the Boltzmann equation for dissipative interaction, for dissipative collision, which has been well studied. So the Gaussian density is related to the heat equation. And interestingly enough, the Lie distribution are related to linear fractional diffusion equation. I will be more precise later on. So, take in the central limit theorem, you have the monotonicity of this sum. And so the main idea is to generalize the idea of using entropies to this setting, to the setting of the central limit theorem for stable laws. And so let us revisit the idea that led to this proof of monotonicity made by Arnstein, Naur, and co-workers, and then I will use more or less the same idea which is in Madiman and Baron in 2007. You know, in theoretical statistics, sorry for this plenty of notion, but theoretical statistics, there is an interesting concept which is called a score. The score, so one takes an observation, then one takes the logarithm of observation, and one takes the variation with respect to some translation, more or less. And what happens is that at the point t equals 0, the score is defined by the, I am in one dimension to be clear. If not, there is the gradient here. In one dimension, the score of a certain random variable with density is f prime of x over f of x. Yeah? And if you try, you see that the linear score has zero mean. But the variance of the linear, the variance is the Fisher information. So the Fisher information is the variance of the score of a random variable. And if you have two random variables with differentiable density function, then you can consider the relative score of one with respect to the other by taking the difference between the two scores, which is f prime of x over f of x minus g prime of x. And this is the relative to X Fisher information is the variance. Yeah? Now, the linear score has this interesting property that is linear if and only if the random variable is a Gaussian. A Gaussian, a normal density, is defined by a linear score, which is minus the Z divided by the variance. Yeah? So among all probability distributions, there is only one which has a linear score, which is the Gaussian. Yeah? And the relative score with respect to the Gaussian, then you write like the linear score F prime over F plus X over sigma. And for the reason that this is linear, you can use the same inequalities with or without this part. So Blackman's time inequality still holds if you have addition of a linear part. All the other inequalities hold if you add a linear part. This is a peculiarity of the fact that the Gaussian has a linear part of the score. And the Fisher information, the relative Fisher information, is written in this way. Yeah. You take the score, then you take X over sigma, which is the score of the Gaussian, you plug to the square, and then you multiply by the density of X. And if you write in this way, you see that the relative Fisher information is bigger or equal than zero, and is equal to zero if and only if X is a centered Gaussian variable of variance sigma. And now, if you think in this way, taking the relative Fisher information, nothing is against to extend the same concept to cover fractional derivatives. In other words, you take a random variable in X, which is distributed with a certain probability function, and suppose that this probability function has a well-defined fractional derivative of order alpha. And then, instead of considering the linear score, let's consider a linear fractional score. Let's say the derivative, the fractional derivative of order alpha of f of x over f of x. This is the same concept. Yeah? And as I said before, I learned about fractional calculus after the reading of a paper of yours with Juan Luis Vasquez. And so I took the definition from your appendix, which are given here. You take, so f of x convoluted with this kernel, and then with a constant which is such that when you pass to Fourier transform, you can write in this way, and some sort of miracle appears. Yeah? That if you define the fractional derivative in the usual way, and then you write in Fourier variable like this, yeah? A difference from the classical case, when you consider the fractional score of x, this is linear, if and only if X is a Levy distribution of order alpha plus one. So this is a direct transposition of the idea of using linear score and Gaussian, which are characterized by a linear score, with a fractional score and the Levy density which possess a linear fractional score. Why this? But it's very simple. You want to identify when rho alpha plus one is linear, which is the same that the fractional derivative of f of x is minus cx of f of x. And then use Fourier transform, and the second, the right-hand side gives you the derivative of f of xi with respect to xi, and the right-hand side gives you this part, and then you integrate with respect to f. The logarithm of f satisfies a certain relationship, and so you obtain this one. So it's very easy. Yeah? But why not defining the fractional score and only the relative fractional score? For the simple reason that if you take a Levy variable, the second moment is unbounded, so you cannot consider only the fractional score. You have to take the relative one. Since this concept, since the fractional score is a Levy density, you have to take absolutely the difference between two them and to plug in. If you discard this, it's not true that this is bounded. It's always unbounded. So in other words, with this concept has a meaning only if you are in a neighborhood, in a subset of the domain of attraction of the Levy stable law. So it's a nice concept, but So let us resume what I did up to now. The fractional Fisher information is always greater or equal than zero, and is equal to zero if and only if is a Lévy symmetric stable distribution of order lambda. And what happens, a difference with the relative standard Fisher information, a lambda is well defined any time that the random variable is has a probability density which is suitable or close to the Lévy stable law. Typically lies in a subset of the domain of attraction. I don't know if the domain of attraction of the fractional Fisher information coincides with the domain of attraction. This is another open problem. I tried many times, but I did not succeed. In any case, the concept of fractional score, you can generalize simply changing the denominator here. You change the domain, you take the fractional score. Instead, this defines another Lévy density with a different coefficient in front of the Fourier transform. Yeah? And let us call this nu, and I plug here nu. E lambda, nu is equal 1, e lambda 1 is equal to e lambda, and e lambda nu is equal to this. So, I don't know if it's easy to follow, but in any case, it's a definition. Yeah? And what can be proved is this one. I will skip all the details of proof clearly, but you can find on papers. Yeah? I think it's enough. Even without details, yeah? Take two random variable and suppose I have two smooth densities and rho one, rho two denote the fractional scores. And then take a number lambda between one and two and a positive constant delta between zero and one. And then you can express the relative score, fractional score of the sum, simply in this way, like the conditional expectation of the sum of two quantities, delta times the first with lambda delta, one minus delta, the second score with lambda one minus delta, with respect to which one plus x2 is equal to x. If you look at the proof, it's very simple. And it's a universal proof that holds independently of the fact that you are using a fractional score or the score. It's simply an easy consequence of the definition. And why this is interesting? It's interesting for the simple reason that when you take the Fisher information, the fractional Fisher information, the fractional Fisher information is the square, is the variance. But then you can use the mean of rho square is less or equal than, it's written simply here, the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, delta square, e lambda delta, plus one minus delta square, e lambda one minus delta. And then there is a scaling property, which is funny. When you have V here and V to 1 minus lambda here, you can put outside V to minus 2 over 1 minus 1 over lambda. Note that when lambda is equal to 2, so we are in the Gaussian setting, this is V to minus 1. But in all the other cases, you have a sensible improvement. And the sensible is given is written here. Take a sum of two independent random variables, take the fractional Fisher information, and then consider this quantity. This quantity is bounded, and then when you plug here the right constant, delta to 1 over lambda, plus 1 minus delta to 1 over lambda, is less or equal than this quantity here. So when you take lambda equal 2, which is the Gaussian case, this is the sum, e lambda of x1 plus 1 minus delta e lambda of x2. Equality when both xj, x1 and x2 are Lévy variables exponent lambda. This is the corresponding of the Blackmann-Stamm inequality that I indicated to you. The Fisher information of the weighted sum is less or equal than the sum of the two Fisher information. But once I have a Blackmann-Stamm inequality, then I can prove more, since I have another argument that, so it goes back to 1948, so the same year in which Shannon postulated this inequality. It has to do with the so-called the U statistics. It's very difficult to find it. But in any case, it's, more or less it says this simple fact. When you have a number n of random variables which are independent, suppose that instead of knowing the whole set
the whole phenomenon, you know only subphenomena of size n. Huh? Instead of knowing from 1 to n, you know only from 1 to n minus 2 for all. And then suppose that you have a function that is called here phi, which ranges on this subset of the certain length. Then when you take the mean of the square, this is less or equal than m over n of a to the phi to the square. So you have some sort of reduction of the second moment. And then you can use this. This is a fundamental in proving monotonicity of the Fisher information. You apply what is called variance drop inequality of Hölding to the relative score, and then you prove simply this, that you take Tn, which is the sum of the random variable to n, you divide by n over lambda, and then you prove that the lambda Fisher information of Tn is decreasing, and you have this bound, n minus 1 over n to 2 minus lambda over lambda. Note that the fact that we are in the stable setting, you have a rate, we have a rate, which is 2 minus lambda over lambda. When you plug here lambda equal 2, you know, you only have monotonicity. So this gives a big difference, which more or less is expressed here. You have some sort of convergence of the sum. E lambda Tn converging to 0 means at a certain rate means that the density is converging in relative Fisher information to the Levy density, and then you have the rate. And this makes a strong difference between the classical central limit theorem and the central limit theorem for stable laws. In the first case, you have a very large domain of attraction. It's enough that a random variable at the second moment that is bounded, but you have a very low convergence in relative Fisher. So only monotonicity is guaranteed. If you take a very restricted domain of attraction, in this case, then the relative Fisher information is very strong, so you have the rate. And so when I got this result, the first thing that I started to think about is, but the domain of convergence of the relative Fisher information is empty, since maybe it's a nice concept, but there are no densities which are inside. And it happens. Yeah? So it's a nice concept which is completely useless. Yeah? And so I tried to find an example of a function which is inside. And if you look at the first paper in which I derived this, you take the representative is this function, which is called Linick distribution. It has no expression in the Fourier space, but in physical space, but in Fourier space is 1 over 1 plus x to the power lambda. It's some sort, you cut a to the minus lambda to some point, and then you got, and this is a good probability density for all lambda, but when lambda is bigger than 1, you know that this is in L1 of R, and then when you apply the inversion term, you know that P lambda is really a probability density function. So you can derive the relative fractional Fisher information, and it can be proven that there are computations. Unfortunately, you have a concept which is in the physical space, and you know properties which are in the Fourier space. It's not obvious that you can pass from the one to the other, so it requires a certain amount of computation. But at the end, I succeeded to prove that the set of probability density function which are inside is not empty. Yeah? And so he was happy. Maybe not too much. Since at that time, so I was happy, but what means convergence in fractional Fisher information? So does it mean convergence in L1? I don't know. And this is the reason why I started to think about. Since in the classical case, one can pass from Fisher to the relative entropy by means of the entropy power inequality. Here, the entropy power inequality is not known, but can we save something? And so I started to think about, and instead of using the classical Fokker-Planck equation, so I don't know if it is well known, but if you want to prove the logarithmic Sobolev inequality, you can use exactly the entropy-entropy method. So take the derivative of the relative entropy with respect to the Fisher, with respect to the Fokker-Planck equation. Then take the derivative of the derivative, let's say the entropy, the derivative of the entropy production, and then you establish a relationship between the two, and then you prove the logarithm is obvious inequality. So the first attempt to do was to, let's take this equation, yeah, in which here, instead of the real derivative, there is the fractional derivative of order lambda minus one. And if you note, this is exactly, if you divide by f, inside you have the fractional feature, so the fractional score. So essentially, the Fokker-Planck equation is the derivative of f times the score, if you take the Fokker-Planck equation, the relative score, and is the f times the derivative with respect to x of f times the fractional score in the case of the fractional Fischer information. And this equation, since this kills out, it becomes to zero only when you are in a Levy distribution, let us call omega of x this Levy distribution, this is the stationary solution of this Fokker-Planck equation. So this fractional Fokker-Planck equation, a Levy distribution like a fractional solution. And so, like doing the same computation that you are doing in the classical case, you fall down saying that if x is t is a random variable, which is given by the sum of two. One is y, and the other one is zeta lambda. And then they are multiplied by two function of time, and the alpha of t is e to the minus t to lambda, beta of t is one over e to minus t to one over lambda. They satisfy this relationship. This has a density which is the solution of the fractional Fokker-Planck equation. And if you put lambda equal two, then you have the exact formula for the real solution of the Fokker-Planck equation. So what says that the solution of the Fokker-Planck equation is obtained, the density is obtained as a convolution of two densities and interpolate continuously between the initial datum and the Gaussian. In this case, you start from an initial datum and interpolate with the Levy distribution. And you can write the solution in this way. The variable x t has this density, and f of x t solves the fractional Fokker-Planck equation, and similar to the Fokker, so what I said before. I don't insist too much since time is running, so I think. Write this in Fourier, and if you write in Fourier and you integrate along characteristic, you see exactly that this is what you find in Fourier. And then you repass to the physical space and you see that the solution is the solution that I wrote. Interestingly enough, the Levy density is invariant or under this scaling. Second step, use the relative to zeta lambda entropy, which is written here, and try to do the derivative knowing that f of x t is the solution to the fractional Fokker-Planck. And what happens? If you take an initial density such that the relative entropy is finite, then taking f of x t like the solution of the fractional Fokker-Planck equation, the relative entropy is monotonically decreasing. And it comes easily from the formula of the solution. But interestingly enough, if the density belongs to the domain of orthonormal attraction, then as time goes to infinity, h of ft over omega goes to zero. So this is a result on the Fokker-Planck equation. From one side, you start with a density which is in the domain of attraction of the Levy distribution. You prove that this, without rate, converges to zero. And only one line of computation. You take this equation, you write the Fokker-Planck equation in this way. This is plus x over lambda. X over lambda is exactly the fractional score of the Levy distribution. So it's simply the difference between this is the fractional score, and then you take the derivative. The derivative, it can be written in this way. And this way, we know that this is decreasing, and so this is a sign, and this is a positive function. Yeah? And then you apply Cauchy-Schwarz. You apply Cauchy-Schwarz. Lambda of f is less or equal than the, let's say, here. This is the composition of two parts. This is the linear score, This is the fractional linear score between F and omega. When I use Cauchy-Schwarz, I get the Fisher information, the usual Fisher information, times the fractional Fisher information to 1/2. But then on the fractional Fisher information, I use the fact that I know this inequality, which is the Blackmann-Stamm inequality. And then I kill one of the two, since one of the two is omega, x2 is omega, and the relative fractional Fisher information is zero. And so I get that e lambda of f of t is less or equal to e lambda of x of t. Let's say half of t to the square, e lambda of t. Well, half of t is a to the minus t to the lambda. So this gives the decay of the Fisher information starting from the fractional Fisher information of the initial datum. And then I use another fact that alpha of t to the power lambda, beta of t to the power lambda, the maximum is bigger or equal than 1/2. And so I proved a lower bound on the e of x t, which is the classical Fisher information, is less or equal than 2 to the power 2 over lambda, minimum between e of y and e of zeta lambda. It is well known that the e of zeta lambda is bounded. There are papers, so for example, by Bobkov and Otto in which they evaluate more or less its value. And so what happens is that the entropy production is less or equal than a function which is decaying exponentially, time a constant which depends only on the initial data and on the Fisher information of the Gaussian. And if you follow with me up to now, then you integrate from zero to infinity, the relative entropy converges to zero, and then you obtain this inequality. Let's say that the relative entropy between x and zeta lambda is less or equal than some constant here, which is related to x and zeta lambda, so it's not exactly a constant since there is dependence on x, times the fractional Fisher information to 1/2. And so any time that I know the decay of e lambda of x, and I know that this is uniformly bounded, that I know the decay of the entropy function. This is some sort of logarithmic Sobolev inequality. It kills down only when x is equal to z lambda. And if you do the same method for the classical Fokker-Planck equation, then you recover exactly the... So in the case of the classical Fisher information, you get the derivative with respect to time of A of H of T is exactly equal to the relative entropy, and then using the decay of the relative Fisher information, then you obtain the logarithmic Sobolev inequality. And so finally, let us go back to the normalized sum, sum over 1 over n to 1 over lambda. And then suppose that initially you have bounded Fisher information, and so you can pass to the decay of the relative entropy once you know that this is uniformly bounded. Since this, we know that it decays. This e lambda of tn is less or equal than 1 n to 2 minus lambda over 2 lambda times. How to prove that e of tn is uniformly bounded? It requires a further investigation, but it can be done. And suppose that you take a probability density function that belongs to the domain of normal attraction of a Levy symmetric random variable, suppose that one is less than lambda equal to 2, and assume that the Fourier transform of F satisfies a sort of condition like this, which is not too heavy, by the way. Then you know that for all n, starting from a certain bound, which is m over 2, Fn is in Hk, and in addition, this condition holds when m equal 2, with when f still is in Hk, with m bigger than 2k over 1 plus epsilon, if f times, this is written here, so it's a technical condition. In any case, depending on the Fourier transform of the initial value, clearly what you can do is to plug inside the Linick density in Fourier and to verify that, for example, all the conditions of this theorem are verified for Linick distribution. So it's a very, And then you conclude that the Fisher information on the sum of Tn is less or equal than C. And then you prove this theorem. If you are in a subset of the domain of attraction, which has bounded fractional Fisher information, then the relative entropy to the Levy density is less or equal than some constant, which depends on x, which is the initial random variable, times 1 over n to some power, times the initial Fisher information. And this more or less closes the picture, since then you can pass from here. Once you know that you are in L1, you know that your initial density is in some hk, then you can interpolate and to prove results in any at least homogeneous Sobolev case as dot a k of r, knowing also the rate. Now, I don't know if the constant that I found are the best. In any case, two things. This is new, at least the way in which you are looking to the central limit theorem for stable laws. And then is new the fact that you can prove convergence in a lot of spaces, since almost all the result on stable density relates to the Russian school, then the problem has been discarded, so let's say we cannot find more, but only in weak sense, in the sense of distribution, and in, there is nothing about strong convergence. I think that, say, wait, so I was running and I will end up a little bit, but in any case, so. Hopefully someone will have something to me to enlarge. So the idea is that you can pass from the classical central limit theorem for using the Fisher information to the fractional Fisher information, which comes out using the same idea which has been used for the classical situation. In the classical situation, you use a linear score function, which is f prime of x over x, and this identifies the Gaussian random variable as the unique random variable for which the score is linear. Yeah? Levy symmetric stable laws are identified as the unique random variable for which the new fractional score is linear. So this is the exact counterpart. The fractional Fisher information that can be fruitfully used to bound the relative to the stable law Shannon entropy through an inequality which is similar to the classical logarithmic Sobolev inequality. And so you can use all the machinery which is done once you have something like the logarithmic Sobolev inequality to obtain explicit rates of convergence in convergence in L1 at explicit rate and for smooth density convergence in various Sobolev spaces still with rate. Yeah? This is my state of the art, and this these are the paper in which essentially, the first one contains some sort of short history of the entropy power inequality, an improvement in the case of log-concave densities. I put inside, since it was the starting point for studying this type of things, and then there is a paper which is about the fractional Fisher information, and then this paper on Journal of Statistical Physics in which this sort of logarithmic Sobolev inequality has been derived, explaining why the fractional Fisher information is a good instrument to prove it. And and then I tried to understand the role of the score function, also in case in which you have a nonlinear diffusion, and this you can find here. Yeah? This is the history. Yeah? And if you remember at least two or three of the definitions that I gave, I will be happy. Yeah? Thank you.